I think we're right on the cusp of looking at how ketone bodies, which are produced in your liver, can really be a steady state fueling for your brain and your muscles and not have the inflammation that we have with carbohydrates.
Hey, I'm Scott Jones from eMeals, and you're listening to Real Food for Real Life. On this episode, I talk with legendary triathlete and six-time Ironman champion, Dave Scott. Dave talks about how adapting a low-carb, high-fat diet, accompanied with the training he does today, that he feels healthier now than he ever did even when he was at his peak performance. Now, before we get to the interview, I have a few housekeeping items. First, send us your questions and comments. We read all of them. And if you have a suggestion for a future guest or a potential topic, I'd love to know that too. You can find us on Twitter at eMeals using the hashtag AskEmeals. We also have an email address. It's community@emails.com. If you don't already subscribe to our podcast, subscribe today. It's simple to do. You can find us at itunes.com/podcast/realfoodforreallife. And while you're there, leave us a review. And finally, if you'd like more information on eMeals and our variety of meal plan food styles, you can find us at eMeals.com. Try any of our meal plans free for 2 weeks, be it paleo, clean eating, or gluten-free. You can even have your shopping list sent directly to Walmart pickup at no charge, so your groceries are waiting for you. That's it. On with the show. Man, I am so excited to have you on the program. I know our listeners will be excited to hear from you. Before we started recording, we were talking about how one might get prepared for a race, and you were, when they're not feeling well, and you were rattling off all sorts of, nutritional supplements and scientific sounding things. So I have to ask the first question, which is, I know you grew up in Davis. You went to UC Davis. Did you ever have a desire to become like a chemist?
As far as following the keto diet, you have to use it sparingly, but no, my background's in exercise physiology, and I was always working with athletes, and part of that physiology is you better understand nutrition, and I kind of have a voracious appetite for that, and also biomechanics. So, I think post school, which has been a lot of decades, I'm an old guy now. I'm very interested in the science and staying up with the science, and ironically, what I was telling a lot of people when we get into the diet part, Scott, was a lot different than what I'm going to tell all your viewers. I thought I was a smart guy and I was really on top of the world. And here I was eating these massive amounts of carbohydrates, which not only for health reasons was not a good idea at all. And we know a lot more now, but also performance wise, it was not the best choice. And, people can look back at my resume and say, well, you won this Ironman 6 times. And I said, I won it, but I think I did a lot of things wrong nutritionally, even though I thought I was on the cutting edge of science.
Yeah. Yeah. And I have to start right there. You were in a category that most people never imagine getting to, performing consistently at this high level. And you're telling me that you felt like your nutrition was off. And I've actually read that you, in many ways, feel like you're healthier today than you were back when you were hammering those Ironman races and like breaking records every time you went across the finish line.
Well, that's exactly right, Scott. I did follow the science along with a lot of the scientists that PhD and MD and folks that published a lot of information following the whole carbohydrate trail. And we know, and I'll say we as a group and in my profession trying to guide athletes, we would tell them that carbohydrates work. They do work. And insulin responds very quickly to carbohydrates. And as an athlete, you become very insulin sensitive. In other words, you're taking that carbohydrate and you're either going to transport it somewhere, you're going to have to store it, and then you're going to have to use it as a fuel, or it's laid down, and there's some of the byproducts of of high carbohydrate intake is a real problem from a health standpoint and also from a performance standpoint, which I can get into. So even though I was professing, boy, we need to make sure that we eat carbohydrates when we're exercising, you need to eat them as the bulk of your total calories during the day. And post-exercise, there's a nice window, and so your muscle and liver glycogen levels, they go up nice and high with carbohydrates. But the irony behind that whole statement is that there is a worldwide movement that has really percolated to the top. And there's been a lot of scientists that have studied a high-fat, low-carb, moderate protein diet for a long time.
Yeah.
But they've really been kind of screened out by their peers. And also what really funds a lot of the funding here, in certainly in this country, whether it comes from the sugar board, whether it comes from the pharmaceuticals, pharmaceutical companies, a lot of the information that was disseminated really came back from a study that was done way back in 1953. And it was a guy named Ansel Keys. And the information wasn't fully divulged. And a lot of scientists now have kind of uncovered this and consequently have now looked at really the full picture. So kind of in a long-winded answer, carbohydrates work. They're not healthy for long-term and not healthy for aging. They're not healthy for your heart, for blood pressure. I can give you a few other variables.
Yeah.
And performance-wise, I think we're right on the cusp of looking at how ketone bodies, which are produced in your liver, can really be a steady state fueling for your brain and your muscles, and not have the inflammation that we have with carbohydrates. So
yeah,
I've kind of flipped things around. Ironically, I was talking to Tim Noakes yesterday, MD and well-renowned scientist out of South Africa, and I think a lot of people have read his book, The Lore of Running, and mm-hmm. he's well published, and he told everyone, you know, eat those carbohydrates. We've got great documentation. And the irony is that he even knew that if we started shifting the diets dramatically, because the ketone bodies that are produced is not some pseudoscience. It happens if you're in starvation. Your body starts producing these ketone bodies. And then you can accelerate that by a normal diet by increasing your healthy fat. Tim Noakes knew all about all this, but again, we didn't really go far enough in advising people for healthy concerns and also athletic performance that a higher fat diet is not 30% of your calories. Even though you can get significant cardiovascular changes and systemic inflammation changes with an increase in healthy fat at that level, to elevate ketones, you have to be about 70% of your total calories in high healthy fat.
Oh, wow. Well, before we go any further, Dave, let's just kind of pause here for a second. And for those of our listeners who may be familiar with the phrase keto or ketogenic diet, help us understand quickly, if you can, exactly what that means from a dietary standpoint.
From a dietary standpoint, it's a real shift in the way we're intaking calories, the way we're storing calories metabolically, the way we're using that as fuel. And when we look at the sort of the breakdown of macronutrients, the healthy fats, and we can talk about healthy fats, Scott, but the healthy fats generally have to be around 70% of the total dietary intake. The protein levels are a little bit higher than what they are in the RDA. So it's a moderate amount of protein, but very low carbohydrate. And the carbohydrate we're looking at is net carbohydrate. So it's taking right. the fiber grams out, and it yields the net carbs. For people that are sedentary, very good studies in looking at this, about 70% in healthy fat. And looking at the total grams of carbohydrates, net carbs per day, is around 50 grams. Now, everyone varies, but for athletes, that number can be a lot higher because our output is a lot higher.
Mm-hmm. And then what happens physiologically?
Well, your body's not dependent upon insulin, and it is with glucose, with sugar. So any type of carbohydrate that you take in is broken down into sugar. Your pancreas releases insulin, and that drives your ability to you know, sustain life. And your brain likes glucose, your muscles like glucose, your heart likes it, your liver has to process it. But the problem is that if there's too much, there's a lot of bad second byproducts, negative byproducts of taking in too much sugar. So in lieu of doing that, when you're taking a higher healthy fat, your liver's producing these fat bodies called ketone bodies. Mm-hmm. And that fuels your brain, and it also fuels your muscles. And so the two fuels are either glucose or ketone bodies. Those are only two things that can fuel your brain, which require a lot of energy, and they also can fuel your muscles. But the great thing about the ketone bodies is that there's no inflammation. I mean, basically zero. And so it negates all the elevated glucose sensitivity that you have or heightened. So a lot of people end up becoming glucose intolerant or glucose resistant. It affects the hormones that regulate blood sugar. So there's a lot of pluses in making sure that you're having a high healthy fat diet, so you start producing these ketone bodies, and you can actually measure that. A lot of athletes will know intuitively, oh yes, I'm now burning this fat-based ketone body, and I'm not dependent on sugar to sustain my fueling. With the carbohydrate diet, we're basically having to eat about every 2 to 4 hours, mm-hmm. because we're kind of hungry. With a ketogenic diet, because you have this long-term, very unlimited amount of ketones available, you may find windows where people, and there's a lot of scientists that are doing, a lot of people that are following this, a lot of athletes that are doing that, they go 6 or 8 hours without eating. Mm-hmm. I'm not necessarily recommending that for a very active person, but you know, the irony is that you're not going to need one of the macronutrients, and the macronutrients that we really don't need is carbohydrates, even though the ketogenic diet is defined by low net carbohydrate.
Right. And so just to clarify, you know, I know there's a lot of confusion about the differences between a ketogenic diet and, say, the paleo diet, which I think folks think is kind of real meat heavy. That's really not what the ketogenic diet is about, correct?
Yeah, correct. I mean, if we look at, I think, you know, that because the healthy fats, which I've mentioned a couple of times, are like, what are healthy fats? Well, certainly meat is in there, and grass-fed beef is the best form of it, because it produces an omega-3 that really helps your brain. It's called conjugated linoleic acid, CLA, and that CLA helps permeate the dura of your brain. So that's one. But we look at cold water fish. So right. Salmon resonates to the top. That's a huge one. But there's a whole list. Sardines and anchovies are in that list. Tuna as well. I have a big list that I send out to people. Olives are a good one. Cream, butter. We think, wow, really? All these things that have saturated fat. Coconut oil. Olive oil. All the super nuts, the king and queen of nuts, almonds and walnuts, but macadamia nuts and Brazil nuts are also very healthy. And seeds are in there as well, so chia seeds and hemp seeds.
Right.
So that whole area of healthy fats is quite broad. And when people think to you, you know, I don't really know what to eat. You know, eggs are in there, and avocados. I mean, the list is kind of endless. But we really want to try to stay away from the packaged fats, the ones that sure. have the heated fats, the trans fats. And those are the ones that really cause a lot of issues, along with the high carbohydrate intake.
Sure. So you could theoretically be a vegan or basically a vegetarian or pescatarian and still, you know, follow a ketogenic diet, correct?
Yeah, and this is a really good question, Scott, because I know there are a number of vegans that are able to stay on a ketogenic diet, and you have to eat, you know, mountains of healthy fats,
right.
And coconut oil is a good one, lots of avocados and nuts and all the things I just mentioned. But unless you're a pesca, where you're eating fish, the fish are a huge plus. So you can still be a healthy carb base with the net carbs, but I think the fish is a real addition for, you know, this pesca vegetarian, because the cold water fish have the DHA and the EPA that permeate the brain. And even if I have all these great plants that have a lot of different compounds in them and have low levels of omega-3s, the absorption of that for the brain is really small. It's about 1-3%. So my concern with vegan athletes is that they're not getting enough quality omega-3s, which really right. affects brain function. Again, the pesca ones, I'm all in on that. If they're lacto-ovo, then they're adding the milk. And the milk, if they are having milk because it has lactose or sugar in it, it really should be whole fat milk or whole fat yogurt. Not the vanilla kind, because all of a sudden the grams of carbohydrates.
Yeah, just pump it with sugar.
Yeah, exactly.
So backing up a little bit, now that we've kind of unpacked the nutrition part of it, you know, just help us understand how you went from this elite athlete, poorly fueled, to realizing that you needed to make a change in terms of how you were fueling yourself and nutrition. Like, what was the tipping point?
I think, you know, kind of looking at all the factors, and now there are measurable factors looking at what really can happen with a high carbohydrate diet, high elevated uric acid, high C-reactive protein. These all go down with a ketogenic diet, and blood pressure goes down, visceral fat disappears, muscle mass increases. I mean, there's so many great things, and I'm going, golly, I had so many ups and downs when I was training, and I was kind of an all or nothing type A crazy guy that would look at my exercise routine, and it was really by myself, and say, you know, I'm going to run 12 miles today, and if I procrastinated because I really feel fueled on an even psychological plane because I was taking so many carbohydrates.
Yeah.
Quite often I just say, well, I'm not going to do it. And it's almost like an alcoholic where, you know, it was all or nothing. And so if I could run 8 miles as opposed to 12, I wouldn't do it. It was sort of a self-inflicted pain. And, you know, I had admitted this many times in chats similar to this podcast, Scott, and I've mentioned to other people. I really think that the tipping point in this was kind of looking at the massive amount of carbohydrates that I had taken in, and that affected my mental and emotional state, which ultimately affected my ability to be consistent in training.
You know, you just mentioned C-reactive protein, and I remember having a blood test that measured that, and it was about inflammation in my arteries. So, I mean, sounds like a lot of those carbohydrate-related things are, you know, dealing directly with inflammation of our internal systems.
Yeah, it's a direct correlation, and again, one of the worst things that we see, and I'm, you know, you're a very accomplished athlete, Scott, as well. We see this kind of movement with our population coming into athletics, whether it's triathlon or running or cycling, and we see a lot of people that are overweight and obese because that's a reflection of our society. And it's not that they're not exercising enough. It's because they're not eating properly.
Wow.
And the magnitude of products that are out there, and I was paid by many companies to support fluid replacement drinks like Gatorade, to support carbohydrate-laden gels. And now there's gummy bears and little waffles and all sorts of things. And people are just surrounded by this myriad of very refined carbohydrates. And I just, I just shudder at this. And it's a, you know, and I don't look at it first as performance issues. I think of it as a health issue.
Absolutely. So, you know, I know that you are now pouring yourself into training athletes. So, you know, in your heyday, you were knocking out an Ironman in, you know, just a little over 8 hours. You know, now, you know, what are your recommendations for, you know, what does a fueling strategy look like for, you know, that person that's going to be out on the course for, you know, 12, 14 hours?
Well, maybe I'll start with what you don't want to do. Because this can put you in trouble. Just a couple of days before the race, I always have people back up on their dinner, finish dinner earlier, because you want that transit time with the early morning start on race day to make sure that you've eliminated that food. So I always tell people finish dinner at 6 o'clock, two nights before, and that will help, because if you're getting up at 3:30 or 4, which is very common for these early races, and you're having a little bit of fuel, you're not going to have your GI tract all backed up, and you'll be able to eliminate that food. So that's number one. The breakfast should be fairly small. Again, you know, we talk about carbohydrate adapted or fat adapted. If it's fat adapted, it needs to be very tiny. And I tell people, almost less is better, even for an Ironman distance race for a 12 to 14 hour fat adapted athlete. I would tell them to keep their total number of calories, and there's 9 calories per gram in fat. But again, if they're fat adapted and they're burning these ketone bodies, I tell them to keep their breakfast at 150 calories or less.
Wow, that sounds
minimal.
Yeah, shocking to hear. Yeah,
it's shocking because a lot of people say, "Well, see, I'm out there good for 12 or 13 hours. Hypothetically, I'm going to need 1,000 calories before I start." And when you put that big bolus of food in there and you start your exercise, that water's drawn in your GI tract to try to break it down. So even on a carbohydrate adapted person, they're going to be dependent upon carbohydrates. I try to keep their total volume for their morning breakfast, regardless of lean body mass or the pace that they're going. But everyone's a little bit different, between 250 and 450 calories. So a lot less than what I think other coaches or trainers would say, oh, you need more calories. I'll say less. The single biggest mistake, once you're close to the actual starting time, is taking in a food replacement drink or gel. And I get a lot of people, oh, gee, I got 10 minutes before the start of the race. I'm going to take 100 calories of a simple carbohydrate.
I see that all the time.
Don't do that. Don't do that. Your blood, your pancreas is going to go nutty. It's going to release a lot of insulin. Your blood sugar is fine. Now you just put it in haywire state. So, it just makes me cringe when I see people do that, or they take their food replacement drink and they guzzle it down. Like, oh my gosh, that's nutty.
Well, this is all great stuff, Dave. Let's just, transition to Dave Scott today. What are you doing now to keep your edge? And, are you focusing on strength training? I mean, what's a...
I'll start with the tail end of your question. I think the strength training, I've always been a huge proponent, even when I first started in this sport in 1978. And before that, when I was in college and high school, I just felt like, strength training, obviously the evolution of that, what does that mean, is huge. And also increasing or at least getting back to the level that you were, the mobility in your joints and the flexibility in your connective tissue and tendons and muscles. So all three of those work hand in hand. I'm crazy about doing it, Scott. I do strength training, mobility, and stretching. I stretch every day because I have some issues with my hip flexor and low back. I do strength training 3 days a week.
Yeah, yeah. Well, listen, Dave, thank you so much for your time. You've been incredibly generous with sharing all this great information. And like I said, I'll have links to all of your various social media channels, your website, the camps, and all that in the show notes, so folks can get in contact with you and read up more on all the cool stuff that you were sharing today, and then even beyond that. So just thank you so much for your time. I really appreciate it.
Well, thanks, Scott. A pleasure chatting with you, and hopefully we gave your audience a little seed of new information.
Oh, I know you did. Thanks so much.
You've been listening to Real Food for Real Life. Subscribe today and you'll never miss another episode. You'll also have access to past episodes with terrific guests ranging from cookbook authors to paleo experts to clean eating experts to fitness pros. You can find us at itunes.com/podcast/realfoodforreallife. And when you subscribe, be sure to leave us a review. You can also find us on other popular podcast apps like Stitcher and Google Play Music. If you have questions about this episode or our podcast, feel free to email me at community@emails.com, or you can tweet them to me at emails using the hashtag AskEmails. To get more information on emails and our variety of meal plans, visit us at emails.com. Until next time, I'm Scott Jones. Thanks for listening.